Okay. Do you need a definite?
Yeah.
Okay, in recent years, a great amount of work has been written to theorize the notion slow cinema. The crucial moment that sparked these discourses was when Nick James made a critical comment on the trend slow cinema in an issue of Sight and Sound, accusing slow films that, quote, they demand great sweat of our precious time to achieve quite fleeting and slender aesthetic and bleaker effect, unquote. To account for the values of slow cinema and its slowness in response to this critique, film scholars have attempted to theorize this notion more rigorously. What is slow cinema? Despite minor differences in their discussions of slow cinema, film scholars have thus far reached this loose consensus regarding its examples and its aesthetic characteristics. The term slow cinema, which recently appeared, has tended to be used to refer primarily to recent international art films characterized by stillness, emptiness, excessive duration, and uneventfulness. The slow cinema feels sparse and thin narrowly only includes unromantic mundane incidents, as critics often say about it, nothing happens. Stylistically, slow cinema is generally minimalist, using static frames or very slowly moving cameras, long shots, long takes that last very long, and aesthetic mise-en-scène. These films, for example, include the works of Hou Xiaoxian, Chai Ming-liang, Apicha Pomirazetakul, Bellatar, Love Vilas, and Yuri Gilgisela. But some film critics and scholars also trace this category of film back to earlier art films, such as Italian Neorealist films and Italian Modernist films, and even the work of Ojas Jiro, in that these films show these characteristics early on. Slow films thus are considered to counter plot-driven, fast-paced films produced by Hollywood as well as other mainstream film industries. For the writers of slow cinema, the slow cinema's aesthetic qualities, far from being politically irrelevant or neutral, are of utmost political significance in that by slowing down the fast paces of modern life and preserving the supposedly insignificant details of life, these slow cinematic qualities serve to redeem supposedly unproductive temporalities as worth experiencing against global capitalism's increasing tendency to accelerate the processes of production and consumption. The notion of slow cinema then is aligned with that of slow food, or more generally, that of slow life in terms of their cultural and political significance. Despite their due emphasis on the political significance of the aesthetics of slow cinema, however, I would argue the existing discourses on slow cinema have largely overlooked the unwanted possibility that its temporality may become subsumed under what Michel Foucault calls neoliberal mentality by serving as what Jean-Jacques Agamben calls a biopolitical dispositive. As Foucault notes, neoliberal mentality, a new mode of power distinct from sovereign and disciplinary modes of power, is characterized by, among others, the subsumption of the hitherto non-economic under economic calculation. If a slow life, expressed in a slow film, such as aimlessly wandering around the city, was in the past considered to lie outside economic domains, this same life, in the present neoliberal era, may be promoted as an investment of time for intensifying the creativity of one's work. Although it may relieve one from strict disciplines, that only demands the slow life, when calculatedly packaged, may serve as a different kind of dispositive that functions to make hitherto unmeasurable vital powers measurable and evaluable. In delusion that is worse, slow cinema proponents have not considered how it may function as a dispositive for machinic enslavement, where, quote, human beings themselves are constituent pieces of a machine, unquote. Then, can we, and if so, how can we, re-theorize slow cinema in a way that can disenslave the spectator from biopolitical voluntarily, and instead offer him or her a potential for becoming beyond measurable? I propose a new theory of cinematic slowness by closely rereading Lucas's cinema books in view of his earlier theory of the free synthesis of time. More specifically, I would argue how we can distinguish between two modes of cinematic slowness, that is, slowness as crystal image and slowness as pure form of time, and how the latter mode allows slow cinema to absolutely detentorialize itself from neoliberal machine enslavement. Clearly, the thinkers of slow cinema have often described it as a kind of delusion time image, noting that slow films show many characteristics of the time image, such as its disengagement with the fast-paced, plot-driven movement image, its presentation of characters as seers rather than agents, and its frequent presentation of nothingness, empty spaces, and dialogue. The problem is, however, that these thinkers engage with Deleuze somewhat cursorily, referring only to what he calls the pure optical and sound situation, and by bypassing all other complexities and developments of the time image he explores throughout cinema too. Then, how can we more rigorously theorize cinematic slowness from the Deleuzian perspective? When the thinkers of slow cinema attribute its characteristics to the pure optical and sound situation, it is in itself not wrong. Insofar as this situation has a tendency to break with the movement image's sensory motor link, it clearly contributes to our sense of slowness by hindering the narrative image causal progression. And yet, this negative characteristic alone would not be enough to account for the intensity of cinematic slowness, which I think is crucial to the temporal density of slow films. After all, pure optical and sound images are actual images that extensively represent time. Thus, I would argue it is better to ascribe cinematic slowness to the characteristics of what Deleuze calls the crystal image, since this image is, as Deleuze notes, quote, double-sided, mutual, both actual and virtual, unquote. The inherent virtuality or intensity of the crystal image I would propose constitutes the first mode of cinematic slowness. This is because, as Deleuze highlights through his reading of Deleuze's Matter and Memory, the virtual component of the crystal image belongs to a more delayed or relaxed level of time than its actual one. To illustrate it through Bergson's famous metaphor of the cone, the crystal image is formed when the actual image marked by the point S and its virtual image marked by A double prime, B double prime are indiscernibly coalesced, and it is visually clear how a more delayed level of time haunts the actual image, which consists on the most contradictory level of time. In this way, the crystal image gives the spectator a paradoxical feeling that the same image feels slower than it actually appears. And this accounts for the intensity of cinematic slowness. It should be noted, however, that this first model of cinematic slowness can be subsumed under neoliberal governmentality, insofar as the intensity of slowness is subject to a system of measurement or evaluation, though of a different kind from what that measures time in terms of its extension. To clarify this point, it is necessary to reread Deleuze's cinema books in view of three syntheses of time he develops in different cinematization. According to the level book, the crystal image appears in the second synthesis of time, which presupposes that temporal intensities are commensurable with another, in terms of the degree of dilation or contraction, as Bergson's metaphor of the cone geometrically suggests. For this reason, while it transgresses the disciplinary norm of time that demands us an ethic of fast-paced progression, the intensity of slowness inherent in the crystal image is nonetheless measurable and is subsumed as economically calculable and manageable under the neoliberal mentality. However, entities imbued with what Deleuze calls the pure and empty form of time, cinematic slowness gains its incalculable intensity and thus becomes deterritorialized from the machinic enslavement of neoliberal governmentality. This is where the second mode of cinematic slowness appears. Although in his cinema books, Deleuze does not explicitly but only implicitly consider it, in different cinematization, he discusses the concept, the pure and empty form of time that constitutes the third synthesis of time, as the most important for understanding the time for producing a pure economy. According to Deleuze, unlike the crystal image or Bergsonian theory in general, code, which includes difference, but in order to subordinate it to the same and the similar, unquote. What is crucial about the empty form of time is its potential to overrun the same and the similar, and thus to disjoint and ungrounded difference from any common ground or common measure. When cinematic slowness assumes the pure form of time, then it liberates the spectator from the neoliberal attention economy of cinema and allows him or her to endure the process of becoming one another with no horizon or expectation. Although my theory of cinematic slowness would be useful to rethink about the aesthetic or political potential of any slow film, I focus on Chang Ming-yang's 2013 film Stray Dogs as a case study. Chang Ming-yang is a Malaysia-born, Taiwan-based filmmaker. Because of the minimalist narrative and minimalist style epitomized as the steady low take, his films, especially more recent ones, have been discussed as quintessential slow films. Chai's Stray Dogs is particularly interesting because it gives the spectator a chance to experience slowness in both the first and the second mode. The structure of the film suggests this division of slowness into the two modes. The film is divided into two parts, like a 14-path narrative film. The first part portrays an impoverished life of a family, whereas the second part places the same family in an affluent middle-class environment. Curiously enough, the two parts are both slow, characterized by tenuous narrative links, minimalized plot element, and monotonous and minimal style, such as the frequent use of steady long shots, long takes that last enormously extended durations. Despite the similar minimalist style and fragmented narrative they employ, however, The two parts feel differently so because of the two different situations in which the family are. If slowness in the first part highlights the intensity of precariousness and desperateness, the second part is slow in a way that intensifies boredom and melancholy. It is almost as if Stray Dog juxtaposed a film like The Seeker's Umberto D and with a film like Antonioni's La Ventura. The reason of this difference in slowness, I would argue, is that the first and the second part are differently characterized as the second mode and the first mode of slowness, respectively. The first part depicts the downtrodden family's slow life in pure forms of time, that is, in an enduring yet desperate way rather than evoking any more delayed levels of time. In doing so, this part opens onto a radically indeterminate future for the family's trait. By contrast, the second part describes the same family, mainly with crystal images, evoking more delayed ways of life that the family might have missed. In this respect, by avoiding running the risk of taking an immeasurable form of slowness, the intensity of slowness in the second part remains governed within the confines of the economy of slowness. Then I'll show one clip from each part to give you a sense of this difference in the mode of slowness. Okay, this is the father, Dao Chong family's father, who works as a human billboard for advertising luxury apartments. And this is a very long take, which lasts about 8 minutes. Okay, I'll stop here. The next clip is part of the second part, which is also a very, very long day, which lasts about 13 minutes. And you can see the same father and the woman, who seems to be a motherly character. It's not certain. And in the middle of the film, they go out of the house and go into an abandoned building where there is a place for empty place with a painted mural. And they are staring at this mural for about 13 minutes. And the film ends. But we don't see the mural until 30 minutes and stop here. Okay, I'll bring my paper to conclusion by highlighting the significance of this film in terms of the context of slow film aesthetics. By contrasting two modes of slowness, Stray Dog reveals a bright spot in the existing discourses on slow cinema and motivates us to explore radical forms of cinematic slowness beyond those of now mainstream slow films catering only to middle-aged and middle-class cinephile audiences who tend to think slowness only in terms of secured and sustainable life.
Any questions? Do you mind if I ask the same question as before? I think I want to ask almost the same question about memory, actually, which is that I'm interested by this idea of the cone, because if we're usually applying this to a subject, we're thinking of always being at the point of the cone and then moving through as a psychological process. But if we're viewing a film, actually, there's two ways that that psychological project process can be represented, right? It could be like an Antonioni, we're looking at the expression of the person, and we have some knowledge of what their past memories may be and what might be going on in the processes. But also we can have, I'm so afraid to pronounce, Veracitecu, Apicheo, with something in his fit, where the past is actually present, where the virtual is actually embodied in some way, practically. It's there's ghosts and there's a sense of the past living in the present. And both create a kind of a density. And I was wondering if you could maybe talk about that in a way. You gave a lot of examples of like Bernatar and maybe somehow how you occupy this space of the cone. Are we actually in when there's the density, are we actually up in the upper parts of it, no?
Okay, question. If I understand your question correctly, so different levels of time can be coalesced.
Yes.
Or in actual films, Peter Bones is there as well. Different versions, so different levels of time extensively exist differently. So extensively juxtaposed with each other. Correct?
Yes. Or it could be psychological, or it could be internal. It could be manifested, or it could be internal.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
I think first of all, we need to distinguish between virtual and actualization. So when the image remains virtual without being actualized, then the inherent virtuality only exists, only is expected as my psychology, but when it is actualized, becomes realized and manifested, embodied in actual images. But but there's something that makes it more complicated, because it seems like Deleuze says even virtuality itself can be actualized, but without being actualized. So the virtuality itself can take an image, but it can be still distinguished from its actualization. And I think this refers to what Deleuze calls crystal image. So when we see the crystal image, we you can perceive both virtual and actual at the same time. But they are coalesced. You can't discern what the thing is. But it is different from the way in which different layers, different levels of time coexist.
That's a very clear answer, crystal clear, one might say, to a very complex problem. Thank you. Anything else to add? To... Yes, please. Thank you very much. Thank you.